There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free. And things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Hello and welcome. You're tuned in to the best in paranormal talk radio. This is Darkness Radio. I'm your host, Dave Schrader. That good-looking fellow over there, that's Tim Dennis. Hello, Tim.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm confused because it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, even though it's still Halloween.
In October, even.
We're getting a blizzard. Not even late October. This is late mid-October.
Yeah.
And we're expecting 8 inches.
Yeah, I'm confused. I went and got a thing that's supposed to make my life easier with my poor decrepit body to go out and get the leaves up off the lawn. And it just came in time for the snow to fall.
Same with me. I bought a vac mulcher and it hasn't arrived yet.
Yeah.
My 400 pounds of leaves are going to be covered by 8 inches of snow.
Yeah, fun, isn't it?
So that mold should kill my lawn, which that'll give me a reason to have to resurface next year. But crazy. All right, listen, we've got a lot to cover today. A lot to cover with news, strange news from around the world. I'm going to try to filter in a couple of emails, maybe a call or two. But we're going to be more heavily laden with news today because of what's going on. And at the end of the show, Tim, I was contacted by somebody who I hold in high regards, a very intelligent member of my circle of friends who doesn't buy into things easily.
Okay.
He was directed to an audio bit and information he understands, and much of what's said in this can be backed up with the solar cycles and the astrological alignments and so on and so forth. He believed this important enough that he told me I need to listen to this.
Hmm.
So, you know, since we're not up and running doing Theater of the Minds yet, this is almost a Theater of the Mind. And our listeners like to kind of, you know, if predictions are being made, they want to hear about it before the fact, not, oh, listen what came out a year ago, right? When it happens. They want to know about it before things happen.
Yeah.
So we're going to play this audio bit later. It's about 10 and a half minutes. And it's one of those, I don't want to say a mechanical voice because it's not that really horrible voice that sounds like this. It's more humanistic mechanical kind of AI voice that'll put shivers up and down Tim's spine. But I want you guys to listen to the whole segment. Email me in with your thoughts on this and what you think it means. And we'll talk a little bit more in the episode about what I think is going on and some other things brewing that are going to tie in with some of the news stories we have to report on today. Some of the news stories that normally we might just roll our eyes at and have a little giggle about are starting to make me reconsider how we examine some aspects of the supernatural and paranormal.
Hmm.
How about that?
Yeah,
so that's my little tease for today. Let me tell you this, though, Tim. We are a week and one day away from the return of the Holzer Files on Travel Channel.
Yes,
I know
we
people are getting tired of me telling them that, but it's going to keep being reminded. So set your DVR. The Holzer Files returns October 29th. The Phantom Hand is the name of the episode. A lot of cool stuff going on, and I hope you guys will tune in and check it out. We have 13 brand new episodes that begin airing October 29th. Our show will be a little later that night, not in its normal time slot, because we're following the special two-hour Halloween special the Ghost Adventures have put together with their investigation of Joe Exotic's zoo, the haunted zoo. So you got to tune in and check that out, and then stay tuned for the best in paranormal TV programming with the Holzer Files. Cindy Kaza, myself, and Shane are all back. And speaking of that, there are guests next Thursday on the show, Tim.
Very cool.
How do you like that?
I like it.
So you get to hear a little bit about the season from the three of us. Tim will be leading this discussion, and we will be talking about the Holzer Files, season one and season two. We'll also take your questions. So if you want to email me questions for the cast and crew of the Holzer Files, dave@darknessradio.com, dave@darknessradio.com, and we'll weave those questions in throughout the night and use your names so that each one of us know who's asking. And feel free to ask whatever you'd like. We will answer as many of them as we possibly can in the 90 minutes we have together next Thursday. So, with that said, Tim, let us launch, shall we, into today's news. I've got something really cool coming up. I signed my daughter and myself up for this. It is the Metal Dash second annual nationwide virtual run that allows you to simply run, walk, jog, crawl a 5 or 10K. So it's a half marathon anytime.
Okay.
Anywhere. And you get to practice social distancing by choosing your location, whether you're doing it on your treadmill or in your neighborhood. You have from Halloween Day, October 31st, through mid-November to record your time and share your experience and costumes with thousands of followers. So there are 50,000 plus participants since 2019 doing these. You could celebrate your victory with a limited edition glow-in-the-dark Halloween die-cast medal, the marathon bib, that's the sign, the placard you see all of the runners wear,
yep,
and a t-shirt shipped for free to your front door, easy peasy. And a portion of all proceeds raised from this event go to Feeding America, the nation's largest domestic hunger relief organization, assisting 1 in 7 Americans every year. You don't want to wait too long because the event is a limited edition medal of 3,000, and it is the Thriller Metal Dash. So the t-shirt has a cool caricature of Michael Jackson and the zombies. The medal itself is Michael Jackson's werewolf, werecat creature, and it glows in the dark, your participation medal, and your placard. So if you're a Michael Jackson fan, a Thriller fan, or you just want to help raise money for a great cause and be a part of something fun, then join in on the fun. There's a special link for that in today's program. So make sure you look on today's program guide, sign up for the fun run and be a part of it with my daughter and I. You could do it. Now, this is nice too. Maybe you know, health-wise, Tim can't go out and walk 5 or 10K right now.
Oh, yeah.
But if he wanted to, he could go walk 1K a day and register each day for his 1K walk. Maybe he has 5 different costumes he wants to wear while doing that walk. You could break it up over that time as well. There's a lot of leniency in this, but the whole thing is really about helping to raise money, and you get some really cool swag in exchange for joining. I think it's 40, 45 bucks to be a part of the marathon, but do it. It's a cool opportunity. Plus you get some neat swag. My daughter, a huge Michael Jackson fan, and I'm there to support her. So I knew she wanted to do it. She signed up. I've signed up with her. We're going to be walking our neighborhood 5K. It's only 3.1 miles.
That's not all. Bad.
No. And if we do it on Halloween, hell, that's just walking around trick or treating.
That's true. Yeah.
Right. So it'll be a lot of fun. Again, the link for it in today's program guide. So go check that out. Now, people have said to me, Dave, what's going on with your news clip page? Because I've gone there and it hasn't updated. Squarespace, who we host our site through, was going through an update and maintenance, and somehow we lost a lot of our news deals. The wonderful Winnie has gone back in and placed up news stories back into September again. So you'll see the ones when we started doing this in September 2020 till today. You'll see the newer stories today and going backwards. So always the newest news stories are at the top of the page, and then by date going down the page, you can find the older stories that we mention here on the program. So if you're listening to this in December and you wonder, oh, I wish I could see that video, I wish I would have seen that picture, you can go back and find it by going to darknessradio.com and clicking on the news tab. That's how easy it is, Tim.
That's pretty easy, Dave. Yeah.
Right. I could make it easier for you by coming to your house and reading the news to you again.
Well,
and showing you the pictures, but that's really only easier for you.
That is. Yeah. It's pretty tough for you. That's way too simple for right,
especially
the audience.
In today's COVID world, Tim. You got to be careful.
Well, and it's pretty hard to hear you through the mask. I mean, it'd be like, it's just easier to re-listen to the podcast and follow along at home.
All right, Tim, let's begin with the news. A tourist says she's been cursed for 15 years for stealing Pompeii artifacts. When a Canadian tourist, figures Canadians, visited Pompeii back in 2005, she was so taken by the site that she decided to bring some souvenirs home with her. But instead of heading to the shop, she stashed 5 artifacts from the Italian ruins and flew back across the Atlantic Ocean. Now, 15 years later, she sent them back, claiming that she suffered a curse since she stole those historic relics. I was young. I was dumb. She wrote in a letter in cursive, Tim. She wrote a letter in cursive. That itself is becoming antiquated. People aren't going to be able to read that fancy writing no more.
I don't think half the world can.
Kids aren't taught that anymore in schools. My kids cannot write cursive. No, they only type things.
Really?
Yeah. Dude, this is going to sound ridiculous to you. Some of my younger children do not know how to sign their name. You think that's stuff that they teach you in school? They don't anymore.
How do they sing the Terrence Trent D'Arby song if they can't sign their name across their heart and want people to be their baby?
First of all, yuck for Terrence Trent D'Arby reference, but I don't know. That's all I got to say. I don't know. I wish I had an answer. Right. Anyway, she says, I was young. I was dumb. I wanted to have a piece of history that couldn't be bought. I never thought about what I was actually taking. I took a piece of history captured in time that has so much negative energy attached to it. People died in such a horrible way, and I took tiles that related to that kind of destruction. The woman, identified only as Nicole, of course it's a Nicole, sent the letter to the Archaeological Park of Pompeii with 2 white mosaic tiles, 2 amphora vase pieces, and a ceramic wall piece, according to CNN. First of all, dick move, Nicole.
Yeah.
One souvenir is dick enough, but to have removed 5 different pieces, you realize if everybody that visited just took one, there'd be nothing left to see.
No, true. Yeah.
Nicole took 5. She's paying for it, though, Tim. The letter went on to describe the negativity that has come into her life since the objects have been in her possession, Tim.
In all fairness, Dave, she's got relatives. I'm just saying that.
Bad luck is something that has plagued my family and myself ever since, she continued. I'm now 36. I've had breast cancer twice, the last time resulting in a double mastectomy. My family and myself have also struggled ever since financially. We can't seem to ever get ahead in life. Tim.
Yeah.
Did you steal something from Pompeii?
Oh, you mean because of the whole financial thing?
You and me both. I thought it was just radio. Maybe we shouldn't have stolen things from Pompeii, Tim.
Well, I had to ship that fountain piece by piece back from Pompeii, but hey, I got it all back here.
Yeah, but unfortunately, you're not good at putting it back together. It's very abstract looking now.
No, it now looks more like a huge, giant penis-shaped super soaker. But yeah, it looks beautiful in the backyard.
It did, yeah.
Yeah.
Sitting at the foot of Mount Vesuvius, Pompeii was destroyed by the volcano's eruption in 79 CE. The quick-moving lava covered the city in almost 20 feet of ash, preserving much of the ruins below it. A spokesperson for the historic site told CNN that over the years, about 100 tourists have sent back items they stole, citing bad luck. In fact, they've put some of the letters and returned items on display in the Pompeii Antiquarium. Like the others, Nicole hopes her action will be able to change the course of her life. We're good people. I don't want to pass this curse on to my family, my children, or myself anymore, she wrote. Please forgive my careless act that I did years ago. I really have learned my lesson. So, Tim, would you return it or would you mail it to somebody you don't like a whole lot? Hey, thought of you, wanted you to have just a little piece of Pompeii. What would you do? What would you do, Tim?
You know, if I developed the big C and I've got financial issues and all that other stuff, I think I'm personally returning the items right back to old Pompeii.
Okay.
I'm taking all the financial hit. I'm getting on a plane.
You're not
going
to go gift it to that guy at McDonald's that only gave you 5 McNuggets when you ordered 6, Tim?
I don't have the wormy McNugget issues like you do, Dave. I'm getting back on that plane, making the trip and making the sacrifice. And
oh, you're going to go all the way back. You're going to glue it back together, put it there?
Oh, yes. Yeah, I'm disassembling the fountain in the backyard piece by piece, brick by brick, and managing to get it all back to Pompeii, back the way it was originally assembled. I may have to find Giuseppe and get it all back the way it was.
Giuseppe.
But yeah, I'm doing it.
I'm sorry, Giuseppe, he no more here. He's a cousin of Geppetto. He's a bit of a crazy guy, likes to carve children out of a wood and hang out with them, and a little cricket who likes to sing.
Well, we'll find them all, I guess. Even if I got to dress up like a small wooden boy to attract them, I'll do it.
I can already hear the emails from Italian Canadians right now.
Oh, I know, right?
Yeah. I'm just saying, yeah.
Dear Dave, first of all, I have a relative named Geppetto. He's a very nice man. And the cricket doesn't sing. He more chirps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Get a little whistle. Get a little whistle. All right. This isn't the only kind of bad tourist behavior that occurred at Pompeii. Back in 2018, a travel blogger bragged in an Instagram photo about sitting atop an ancient pillar, an act that is both forbidden and disrespectful. Just in case you were curious, Tim.
Oh, well, sorry. I didn't mean to.
Yeah. Both those things, forbidden and disrespectful. Speaking of ancient weird things, Tim, a large 2,000-year-old cat has been discovered in Peru's Nazca Lines. Now, have you seen this story?
No.
Now, you've seen the Nazca Lines in Peru.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The Nazca Lines, a UNESCO World Heritage Site, is home to designs on the ground known as geoglyphs, created about 2,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. Scientists believe the cat, as with other Nazca animal figures, was created by making depressions in the desert floor, leaving colored earth exposed. The cat then went unnoticed until plans were recently drawn up for a new path leading to an observation platform. The platform would have provided a vantage point for visitors to see many of the other geoglyphs. So here's my question.
Okay.
I'm going to throw a timey-wimey, wibbly-wobbly situation at you.
All right.
How many flights do you think have flown over Nazca, Peru, and have seen those images now?
Probably hundreds, if not thousands. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But new ones keep cropping up. What if, Tim, what if time travelers are doing this? What if time travelers, because first of all, I got to tell you, the Nazca cat looks like, I don't know, a drunk 3-year-old drew it. Not a very good artist. Just got to say that straight up. And I don't know, it may be more like a kangaroo to me than it looks like a cat. It's got the long, thick tail, two pronounced back legs, and then just kind of kangaroo-y looking. So I don't know. I'm not real impressed. But how do they just keep appearing? They're huge geoglyphs. By the way, we just discovered a new. Were you blind? How did you not see it the first time? And it's right there. You're going to build. Listen, you know that hill over there? We should make a new landing site for people to go up and see. Oh, you mean the one with that strange? Shit! It's a cat. We missed a cat, guy. Hey guys, there's a cat over here. How do you miss this?
I'll go one step further, Dave, and a joke that probably won't land with anybody who's under the age of 50.
Okay.
It was time travelers from the 80s who went back to try and extend the life of kangaroo shoes and decided that they were going to try and set up a marketing campaign to get people to notice from the sky the logo of kangaroo shoes and go, hey, whatever happened to kangaroo shoes? I sure would like a pair about now in the year 2020.
Didn't they have the little zipper pocket on the side you could put like your key or change or money in?
Yeah, I had a pair when I was a
figures.
Kid. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Did your mom buy it for you at the Kmart or at Zaire? Hey,
Kinney shoes.
Kinney shoes. Wow, Kinney shoes. Talk about extinct lines.
Yeah.
Kinney shoes. Anyway, scientists believe the cat, as with the other Nazca animals, were created by making depressions. And this picture definitely leaves me depressed, that's for sure. The cat went unnoticed until they planned to drop a new path leading to the observation point. In a statement, Peru's culture ministry said the figure was scarcely visible and was about to disappear because it's situated on quite a steep slope that's prone to the effects of natural erosion. It added that the geoglyph, which is about 37 meters long, Tim, for those of you that are unable to tell meters and feet, that's 120 feet long.
Had no idea, really.
It has since been cleaned and conserved over the past week. I'm wondering, was this a much better cat? And this is like they hired that woman that tried to fix the ancient portrait of the Virgin Mary. Do you remember that news story a few years ago?
Ooh, yeah, I do.
It's beautiful, and she accidentally cleaned it with the wrong stuff, and it cleared it up, so she repainted the face on, and it looked, again, like a third grader painted it.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if that's what they did by accident. It added that the geoglyph, which is about 37 meters, 120 feet long, has been cleaned and conserved over the past week. Do you think they're just adding things up there to keep in the news?
I think so. I mean, you know, it's the Nazca lines don't really get a lot of press. So I think, but, you know, keep it fresh, keep it relevant. You know, clean up the cat a little. You know, I know that's
You want to clean it, freshen it up. I got you. You want to give it a good shave. Shave down the cat once in a while.
Yeah, it's important.
No, yeah.
After this corporate sponsorships, I'm guessing.
Could be. Yeah. Johnny Isla, Peru's chief archaeologist for the Nazca lines, told Effie News that the cat predates the Nazca culture, which created most of the figures from 200 to 700 AD. The cat, he said, was actually from the late Paracas era, which was from 500 BC to 200 AD. We know that from comparing iconographies, he said. Paracas textiles, for example, show birds, cats, and people that are easily comparable to these geoglyphs. So they were the really poor artists of the time. Because I was going to say, it doesn't look like the other very linear, deliberate Nazca lines. This looks like, I mean, have you seen the image yourself, Tim?
I have not.
All right. Prepare for it, my friend. It's coming to you.
Okay.
Are you ready? Are you ready for this, Tim?
I'm ready.
I want you to see it. And maybe I'm just being too harsh on the artist. But and I'll put this new story up over at Darkness Radio so you can go see it. Does this cat just like it, you know, one of these kids is doing their own thing.
Ooh, boy.
It just isn't the same. Isn't that about it?
Yeah, that's poorly done. Yeah.
Yeah.
If I were a Nazca line art teacher, I probably would have failed this student.
Would you say that's more kangaroo-like? One could even say that's a pouch above the back haunch.
It could be. Yeah.
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 Yeah. I don't know how many kangaroos they saw in Peru.
Although the face is very kitty-like.
Is it? Or is it kangaroo-like?
No,
kangaroos have that same kind of face with big pointy ears.
I'll give it a kitty face. Yeah.
Well, since we're talking kitties, Tim, let's go to our next story. Stormy Daniels.
Whoa.
has been spotted ghost hunting in Atchison, Kansas, Tim.
Really?
Sometimes people are out reporting on one story. They find something they didn't expect. And that's exactly what happened to KCTV's Nathan Vickers Atchison. You see, they've been working on a series of stories about haunted houses for Halloween. Mm-hmm. And on a trip to Atchison, Vickers met somebody who's interested in sharing stories of the paranormal. At the historic McIntyre Villa, he bumped into Stormy Daniels, who he seemed to recognize immediately. Would you recognize Stormy Daniels if you saw her? I wouldn't. Now I might because I've seen her picture. But I never had an interest in looking her up before.
Wouldn't know her if she bumped into me.
Yeah, well, it's the same Stormy Daniels, known for her work in the adult film industry, who had that lengthy legal battle with Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And as it turns out, she's launching a show about ghost hunting, because of course she is, Tim. Paranormal Hacktivity. That's the name I'm proposing. Paranormal Hacktivity.
That's a good one. That's a good one. Yeah.
So it turns out she's launching the show. I've always had an interest in the paranormal, Stormy says. She's been filming at haunted houses around the country, including a couple of spots in the Atchison, Kansas area. Vickers had been across town at the Sally House with a mutual ghost hunting contact who put them in touch. The funny thing about ghost stories is that when you talk about an experience, everyone else wants to talk about it, Daniels said. Everyone has had an experience, and a show gives them a safe way to talk about it. Her latest project is known as Spooky Babes.
Spooky Babes, you say?
Yeah. Huh. Spooky Babes. Maybe you want to learn more about it. I don't know. If you do, I've got a link, Tim.
Oh,
which
okay.
I'll put up on today's news feed because that's the kind of guy I am.
Wow.
So there'll be a link to Spooky Babes. You're welcome, America.
Thank you.
You're welcome, world. Okay, so you can check that out. Her production team let the news followers follow them through the 130-year-old mansion. The McIntyre Villa is one of my favorite places, Daniel said. It's the only one I've come to twice. Did you hear, Tim? The McIntyre Manor made her come twice.
Really?
Uh-huh. She feels like she has unfinished business there. She may come again, Tim. We don't know.
That's amazing. Three times, you say.
Pretty crazy stuff happened last time. Daniels was there to talk about ghosts, not the president, but she did have this to say about the election. The big question I have now is, who am I voting for? I think it's clear who I'm not voting for, but I've been careful not to endorse any candidate. I feel like it could be detrimental to the candidate. I'm just here to entertain. Daniels is still pitching her show to a few different networks, but she's also visited some of the other haunted places in Atchison, Kansas, and around that area. So keep tuned, and if you want to know more about Spooky Babes, Tim, the link is in today's news section.
I think I know how much she's getting paid for the show.
How much?
$130,000.
Ooh, why do you say that?
It's a joke. Oh,
I'm not in on that stuff.
Okay.
All right, Tim, are you ready for a little bit more sexy time?
Sure.
How about a little TNA and I, Tim?
Okie dokie.
TNA and I. That's right. A and I, Tim. AI.
Oh, no, Dave.
Bow chicka doom 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 doom. Bow chicka doom 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 doom. You see what I'm doing there? I'm taking the old bow chicka wow wow porn music, mixing it with the Terminator theme. Tim, bow chicka wow wow. Would you date a droid?
No, Dave, I wouldn't.
Oh, R2-D2 is kind of sexy, and he can do all kinds of stuff, Tim. Yeah.
Which
a survey
end in reveals, severing, Dave. Ends in severing.
Maybe. You don't know. Survey reveals a quarter of people haven't ruled out the idea. A quarter of the people that they talked about, Tim, have not ruled out that idea.
And they'll end up dead, having, Dave. They'll end up dead.
Of having a robot as a romantic partner, with the Dutch being the most accepting. Mm-hmm. Do you think they started by making sweet, sweet love to their Dutch ovens, Tim?
What? Of course they did.
About a quarter of people haven't ruled out the idea of dating a robot, according to a new survey, and the Dutch are the most accepting of the idea of artificial amour. Researchers from the University of Twente used data from the EU-backed Siena project that studies ethics and opinions surrounding cutting-edge technology. They surveyed 11,000 people, top 10 answers on the board, Tim. Survey says... They surveyed 11,000 people and found 27% either supported the idea of dating a robot or hadn't completely ruled it out. 72% were completely opposed to the idea of digital dalliance, Tim. In the Netherlands, support for someone having a robotic boyfriend or girlfriend went up to 53%, the highest of the 11 countries involved in the survey. The multinational telephone survey by the Dutch research team has also found that people were uncomfortable with robots that look and behave like humans. We were getting used to interacting with intelligent machines, from robot vacuum cleaners, smart speakers that can control our lights, and AI assistants in our homes. That was my robot vacuum cleaner sound, Tim.
Was it? You need to clean the thing out every once in a while. If that's
a... with. No. Millions of people ask Siri, Alexa, or Google. Whisper those, Tim, because I don't want to alert people. And suddenly when I say, Siri, play Darkness Radio, or Alexa, play the best in paranormal talk radio, Darkness Radio's podcast. Or if I yell out Google or Echo, it's going to happen in my own home.
Oh, will it?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Listen. Echo, play Darkness Radio's newest podcast. Echo, stop. You embarrass me, Echo. Come on. The development and shift.
Wait a minute. How many times a day do you do that? A
couple times.
Okay.
Does that make me feel bad, Tim? You can play it on all of these devices. You don't even have to. You could be so lazy that you don't want to look it up. Just ask your damn device to play it. It'll play it.
I know. I did it on my iPhone the other day.
What?
I played the show.
Oh, did it? Okay. Anyway. Yeah. The developments and shift, I said shift, Tim, towards a world dominated by robots and artificial intelligence devices are already visible, explained the Dutch team. Having a robot clean up the carpet in your living room is very different to taking one on a date or to the bedroom. Is it really, though? Across all 11 countries, just 12% outright support the idea of dating a droid. 15%, they're on the fence. And 72% are completely opposed to it. People were asked how much they agreed or disagreed that it's acceptable if people have a robot as a romantic partner, that is, a girlfriend or boyfriend. I think that number would have been much higher, Tim. Here's why. Because I honestly believe the only people they reached by phone were elderly people. Because nobody I know under the age of 40 answers their GD phones, Tim.
That's true.
So the only people, hello, yes, this is Dutch scientist. Ask question, would you like the sexy time with a robot? Huh? What? I seen it in a movie and I tried to kill everyone. I'm out. Right? That would be it, Tim.
Well, Dave, let me ask you a simple question.
Okay, simple questions are good. I like those.
You ever just walking around the kitchen, you trip and fall into your toaster?
No.
Neither am I.
I will admit that Teddy Ruxpin has given me the eye a few times, and on a lonely night after drinking, I've had to stop myself on a few occasions. Tim, does that make me a bad guy, Tim?
Yes.
Am I suddenly a bad guy?
Yes, you are.
There was a wide variation by country in terms of levels of acceptance to the idea of robots as romantic partners. The Netherlands were the most accepting, 30% agreeing that this is acceptable, 23% undecided, 45% outright outraged and oppressed, Tim. I'm going to say oppressed. The word is opposed, but we really know it's just oppressed. Sweden, South Korea, the U.S., South Africa, and Germany all had more than 10% of those surveyed agreeing to the idea of robotic romance. And we have one of those calls in America, Tim.
Yes. Yes, I would definitely like to make love to a robot. Please send one to me.
It's like a comic book guy, Mr. Burns mash up there. I think I just kicked out Tim.
I think so.
Yeah. Greece, Poland, France, Spain, and Brazil are the countries least supportive of robot relationships.
Because
all their people are hot.
And they can get women and men. Yeah. And they actually
only
can get relationships. 10%
agree to having whoopee with a mechanical partner.
Thank God.
Greece and Poland, though, Tim, were the least supportive of dating a robot. France and Spain, 6% said that they would.
Yeah.
In all countries surveyed, people expect rapid developments in intelligent machines' capabilities to understand and communicate as well as humans. The survey found that 80% of people polled throughout the AI and robotics revolution would significantly change their country over the next 20 years. Under half were positive about that impact that these machines might have on their country, while a third were negative about the possible impacts. The Dutch and South Koreans were the most positive, whereas the French were the least positive, the survey revealed. I will not do it. Do they make a good crepe in the morning? Perhaps I could be swayed then. I don't know.
Mm.
The wider study also examined the implications of artificial life, intelligent machines, and human-like robots on society. More than half thought these technologies would lead them to have less control over their lives, with only 13% expecting to have more control by employing these AI robots. Aside from love life, there was also concern about human-like robots in the workplace, with just over half saying they don't want to work with a bot.
Yeah.
Racists.
Most people are accepting
of robots and artificial intelligence as long as they serve us, Tim, as long as they're willing to clean our dirty floors and make our beds. But heaven forbid they want to make sweet, sweet love to you. Then, suddenly I'm not so sure about that. What if, I wonder if this is going to happen, right? There's that part in some relationships that people have, that marriage comfortability, where one partner is definitely more into sex than the other. Would the least interested in sex allow their partner to have sex with a robotic lover? Because, and I'll throw that out to our audience. Would it be cheating if your partner's making the whoopee with a robot as opposed to like your sister Sarah or your neighbor Pauline? Would you be less offended by that? Would you be okay with that? Or maybe Dirk or Larry. I don't know who your neighbors are. I'm just throwing it out there. But
what do you live next to porn stars, Dirk or Larry?
How many porn stars do you know named Larry? Larry Libido stars in the brand new film.
Larry Libido.
Activity.
Larry Libido lives right next door.
Larry Libido. I like it. I like it a lot. Tim, do we have any calls this week?
Oh, way to put me on the spot. First of all, wait a minute. I have one more issue here on that last story.
Okay.
I need to speak here for a second.
Please.
The major downside to this entire story is this. I don't know why you're so trusting. You're like, oh, yeah, by the way, would you just, let a robot take over your needs? First of all, I know you have GPS on your phone. Okay.
Yes.
And I know every once in a while your GPS goes, turn right here, and you turn right there, and your destination is not there, right? Uh-huh. So AI is not infallible.
But maybe AI with GPS technology will teach men how to find things better on living partners.
Wait. You didn't let me finish.
Go to the left, yes.
You didn't let me finish.
Okay.
Okay.
Which is something a robot lover would never have a problem with. Tip. They'd always let you finish.
Sometimes in the process of trying to finish, it might take a left instead of a right and rip. And then you'll never finish again. Do you get my point? AI is not infallible. I don't know why you people are so trusting.
I'm just saying. All right, listen, I'll tell you what. Since we're talking about love, Tim, I've got a couple more stories. Because even aliens appear to be looking for love, Tim. We have kind of a love fest going on this week, which is really bizarre to me. But three female celebrities have come forward, Tim, with an interesting story.
Okay.
Our first one comes from Hannah Montana herself, Miley Cyrus. Miley thinks she had an alien encounter. The 27-year-old singer has insisted she once had an experience in which she and her friend were chased down by some sort of UFO. But she has admittedly said they were both high at the time after buying weed from a guy in a van.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, weed wax is what it said. What the hell is weed wax?
Oh, yeah, weed wax. It's
heard wax in your weed, but I've never heard of weed wax.
No, wax.
Are those wax lips we used to get as a kid that you chew on afterwards?
No, hardly. No, wax is actually, it's a different form of the weed, and it actually, it's literally a wax. It's a wax compound, and it heats up, and it's not smokable. It actually just melts, and you inhale the melted compound.
So it's kind of like that, like my daughters and wife have around the house, those little heating lamps. You put a cube of wax in and it puts scent in the air. This just puts out the scent of weed.
No. You inhale the melted vapor.
I did not inhale.
Well, you're not going to get any then if you don't inhale the melted vapor.
So she admits she saw the UFO after buying weed wax from a guy in a van. Could you imagine just being some struggling drug seller and Miley Cyrus pulls up. She's like, hey, y'all, got some of that there weed wax?
Somehow that's more normal than you're making it out to be.
I guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
When asked if she's ever looked into the likelihood of alien life, she said, I had an experience. Actually, I was driving through San Bernardino with my friend, and I got chased down by some sort of UFO. I'm pretty sure that's about what I saw. But I'd also bought some weed wax from a guy in a van in front of a taco shop. So it could have been the weed wax. But the best way to describe it is a flying snowplow. It had this big plow in the front of it, and it was glowing yeller. I did see it flying, and my friend saw it too. There were a couple other cars on the road, and they also stopped to look. So I think it was real. I've been told my impression of Miley Cyrus, hands down, is one of the best ever heard.
It is spot on.
I'm surprised. Yeah. People right now are probably like, wow, that wasn't Miley Cyrus?
No.
It wasn't. It was me, guys. Sorry.
No, it was Dave. Yeah.
Miley said the experience was so shocking that it left her unable to look at the sky for days because she feared them their extraterrestrials might return. She added, I was shaking for like 5 days. It effed me up. And she stuck out her tongue, as she is apt to do. I couldn't really look at the sky the same. I thought they might be coming back. However, the midnight sky hitmaker insisted I didn't feel threatened by the unidentified flying object. Speaking to Rick Owens for Interview Magazine, she said, I didn't feel threatened at all, actually, but I did see a being sitting in the front of the flying object. It looked at me, and we made eye contact, and I think that's what really shook me. Looking into the eyes is something that I couldn't quite wrap my head around. But you're so right to say that it's a form of narcissism to think that we're the only things that could be in this vast universe.
Oh, universe.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Very complicated.
I'm reading the direct quote.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Well, Miley's contemporary Demi Lovato also in on this, Tim.
Oh.
Are you ready for this?
Ready.
Let's see if weed wax or booze is involved. After dealing with the ongoing drama of her breakup with ex-fiancé Max Erich, Demi Lovato is understandably looking for a little peace and serenity in her life. And according to her most recent Instagram post, she's found just that through making contact with extraterrestrials, Tim. Over the weekend, the pop star shared a few videos of the night sky and unidentified flying objects with her fans, writing the caption, "The past few days I've spent in Joshua Tree with a small group of loved ones and Dr. Stephen Greer and his CE5 team." According to his Instagram bio, Dr. Stephen Greer is one of the world's most foremost authorities on the subject of UFOs, ET intelligence, and initiating peaceful contact with ET civilizations. He's also the creator of CE5 Contact, a $9.99 app that provides instructions and tools to assist you in making peaceful contact with the extraterrestrial civilizations, as well as locating others in your area who are interested in making contact. So there you go. Dear Dave, I done heard that story, and I cannot recall what the name of that there app was. Could y'all tell me again? No, it's posted. I'll just post this story. You can go read the story, find the name of it. You know, people take so much time to rewrite to me when they could have just paused it and written it down right then and there. Mm-hmm. But I'll put it up for you. I'll put this whole article up so you can go find the name of that there CE5 contact app, Tim.
Mm-hmm.
It's $9.99. You don't even need no weed wax to enjoy it.
Wow.
Interesting. Lovato continued, over the past couple of months, I've dug deep into the science of consciousness and experienced not only peace and serenity like I've never known, but I also have witnessed the most incredibly profound sightings, both in the sky as well as feet away from me. This planet is on a very negative path towards destruction, but we can change that together. If we were to get 1% of the population to meditate and make contact, we would force our governments to acknowledge the truth about extraterrestrial life among us and change our destructive habits, destroying our planet. This is just some of the evidence from under the stars in the desert sky that can no longer be ignored and must be shared immediately. Now, in this article is also the video of her showing what she believes to be alien craft flying in the skies over Joshua Tree, Tim.
Hmm.
She then went on to encourage her followers to download the app for themselves, adding that if it doesn't happen on the first try, keep trying. It took me several sessions to tap into a deep enough level of meditation to make contact. Happy communicating. Lovato isn't the only famous person who had some out-of-this-world experiences. Post Malone also recently opened up on Joe Rogan's podcast about some of the unexplainable sightings he's had over the course of his life. And according to Bill Nye, these musicians aren't wrong to believe there's definitely something else out there. When Vanity Fair asked the science guy if we're alone in the universe on an episode of Inside the Hive last year, he succinctly replied, "How could we possibly be?" And remember, we reported it here last week. Aaron Rodgers. Tim, Aaron Rodgers saw a UFO.
Oh, I thought you were going to say it was smoked by Tom Brady and the Buccaneers. But
no, but he might have smoked some weed wax. I can't be sure of it.
Ah, right.
That's not it, Tim. The trifecta of powerful entertainment women, Miley Cyrus, Demi Lovato, and Khloe Kardashian. Yeah, much like great scientists before her, Tim, Khloe Kardashian is a firm believer in aliens. Though she claimed on Twitter back in 2015, she witnessed a UFO streaking across the night sky. Turns out that's not the only time she's seen this bizarre phenomenon with her own eyes. While recently appearing on the Emergency Contact episode with her best friend, Malika Hagg, the Keeping Up with Kardashian star opened up about when she saw an unidentified flying object while driving around Hollywood. I wonder if she just bought some weed wax from a guy in a van, Tim. Then I'm going to start questioning everybody.
You are really enthralled with the weed wax, aren't you?
I am. Yeah. Yeah. I'd like to be a weed waxer, Tim.
First time I saw weed wax?
Mm-hmm.
Snoop Dogg concert.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Did you partake or you just watched?
No comment.
Okay. Khloe Kardashian may be convinced she saw a UFO back in the day, but her best friend forever, Malika Hagg, isn't too sure about that. During an October 12th appearance on the Emergency Contact with Simon Huck and Melissa Gray, Washington, the reality star recalled the time she witnessed an extraterrestrial while driving around town. "I did see an UFO. It was years ago, and I was driving my Hummer at that time, right?" Kardashian began. "We were driving, and I saw one. We were driving up by the Sepulveda area in the San Fernando Valley, and I told Malika, and she didn't look up fast enough, and I saw a UFO." Though Kardashian is certain she caught sight of the unearthly object, Hagg isn't quite as convinced an unidentified flying object flew the sky that day, and her disbelief has caused her and the Good American founder to get into heated debates. "She didn't believe me. She missed it," Kardashian continued. "Until this day, we argue about it, but I also have a UFO on video that I did see." Hagg quickly chimed in that though she believes Kardashian sees UFOs, she's still on the fence about her friend's alien sightings that happened years ago. "Now I know she's really seeing them," Hagg said. "The debate is really that specific day years ago. I did not see it." Though Kardashian doesn't have evidence that she saw a UFO all those years ago, she does have video footage of what appeared to be aliens shooting across the night sky back in 2015. The reality star was one of many Southern California dwellers who witnessed UFO-like shapes flying in the air. Although the government claimed the sighting was just a missile test, Kardashian believes she saw an unidentified flying object and quickly took to Twitter to share her thoughts about extraterrestrials. Not only did she assert that aliens are real by sharing a video of UFOs flying across the sky, but Kardashian also got her younger sister Kendall Jenner involved by claiming that she saw the unearthly object as well. Yes, folks, the video is in the news story, which is up on our site at darknessradio.com. Click the news tab. "Kendall and I are spazzing out," the revenge body host tweeted. Hashtag we are not alone. Hashtag UFO at Kendall Jenner, she penned in another post. Kardashian even called out the government for trying to conceal the existence of aliens, as she seemed unimpressed by the whole naval test fire explanation. "Of course they are, because the government doesn't want to admit that we are not alone," she wrote, before adding no future details. Yeah, okay. That's just because hashtag we are not alone, hashtag admit it. Though it's unclear if aliens actually exist, it appears Kardashian is 100% certain extraterrestrials are real, Tim.
Hmm.
So there you have it. So that article also on today's page, so you can go check that out. So far, Tim, you've got Demi Lovato's video.
Mm-hmm.
You've got Khloe Kardashian's video, mm-hmm, and story. You've got how to sign up for the 5 or 10K fun run, thriller fun run coming up on Halloween.
Right.
That's all up on the news deal. We even have more to share, Tim. But before we talk about the love that got away, let's take a quick break. We'll be back with more of the best in paranormal talk radio. You're listening to Darkness Radio. We are back. You're listening to the best in paranormal talk radio. This is Darkness Radio Supernatural News Edition, and we're going to get deep here in a few minutes, folks. Deep, Tim.
Deep.
Deep.
Yeah. I also forgot to mention the link to Stormy Daniels' new TV series, Spooky Babes, is also up on the news page, Tim. How about that?
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We just talked about, looking for love. Paranormal activity, Tim, and UFOs trying to make contact with, of course, Miley Cyrus, Demi Lovato, and Khloe Kardashian. But in not all cases does love work out well in the supernatural, Tim.
Hmm.
Uh-huh. This morning, a TV show, I believe in New Zealand, viewers were shocked as a woman calls off her wedding to her ghost fiance. Yeah, you heard that right. Amethyst Realm has appeared on the chat show with Holly and Phil before, where she spoke about her paranormal relationship with her ghost fiancé, Ray. The psychic medium met Ray while on holiday in Australia, and she told the pair how he proposed to her back in England. However, Amethyst returned to give a shocking update on her relationship, telling Holly and Phil the wedding is off now, and their relationship is over. What the hell could possibly cause the end of such an amazing coupling, Tim? A human physical form woman medium and her ghostly lover. Well, thankfully, that's our first audio daily double. Let's hear her story, Tim.
Obviously, things progressed. And last time that we saw you here on the show, you were talking about how much you'd fallen in love, and there was this proposal at Wiki Hole. So things were going really, really well. Where are you now?
So now we've called the wedding off. It was going really well until we went on holiday, and that was about last May, and then he just completely changed. So I think maybe he fell in with a bad crowd when we were on holiday. He just started becoming really inconsiderate. He'd disappear for long periods of time. When he did come back, he'd bring other spirits back to the house and they'd just stay around for days.
Just laying around playing Xbox.
Yeah.
Yeah. First of all, he would disappear for days. That's what ghosts do, Amethyst. Okay? Ghosts, they disappear. But she thinks maybe he fell in to a bad crowd when we were on holiday. He started becoming really inconsiderate. He'd disappear for long periods of time. When he did come back to him, he'd bring these other spirits to the house. They just lay around for days. She continues with saying, I think maybe he started doing drugs and partying a bit too much. I wonder if it's that weed wax, Tim.
Dave, I don't think there's powerful enough weed wax to produce that effect.
I don't know. If there's any weed waxers out there that could get a ghost high, let me know. Clearly confused, Phil, the host, asked, how is that possible? Was he partying in this world or in the spirit world? Well, I think partying in both, judging by he disappear for a while and then come back to mine, she replied. Phil then asked how she broke the news to Ray, which she explained that she gave him one last chance, but he didn't change him. So she cleansed the house to get rid of his spirit. She eventually ended up placing black tourmaline around the house, which keeps spirits away. I did a sage cleansing, incantations. I just had to get rid of him, as you would any other spirit, really. Viewers were left shocked at Amethyst's story, taking to social media to share their thoughts. I'm so confused right now. I'm all for what makes you happy, but surely this is someone trying to have a laugh with everyone who watches. That's what one viewer wrote. Mm-hmm. While another who questioned the story saying, I felt she was playing them, and she knows exactly what she's doing. 15 minutes of fame. A third one said, I've seen it all now.
Rolf the dog said, I've seen it all now.
Maybe you want to see the entire interview for yourself, Tim? Yeah. Boy, where could they go to see that? Gosh, how do we direct them over the air? Oh, just go to darknessradio.com, click on the news tab. That story is there along with the actual full-length interview. And you can judge for yourself. Is she crazy or are we crazy for not believing her? That's where we'll leave it, Tim.
I got a good guess, but keep that to myself.
Let's take a call, Tim. We have the Voices from Beyond voicemail. We want to hear from you, the caller, 651-300-4977. You can call in and be a part of our show. Share your story, 651-300-4977, just like this caller did.
So my story starts off about 12 years ago. We moved in with my mother-in-law for financial reasons to help her, and our townhouse was being sold. So we were helping each other out. My husband, my son, and my dog all moved in. And I consider myself a person who can get along with just about anybody. I try to. It quickly became apparent that my personality and my mother-in-law's personality were nowhere close to being similar. She was not a very affectionate mom, and I am exactly the opposite with my son. I don't think it was anything to do with no one's good enough for my son or anything like that. I think it was just seeing someone happy in a relationship or just being happy in general. She was not a big fan of being a witness to that. So little things started to happen when my husband would go to work. She would do things on purpose to get a rise out of me. For example, mop water. If she was mopping the floor, she would swing the mop in my direction with trying to hit me with it. She would just try to get a rise out of me. It was definitely a test of strength on my part and how much I could handle as a human being. It was a lot to go through. So those feelings came about fairly quickly. And just my son and I and my husband just tried to stay away from her to not cause any problems. And that just seemed to make her more angry and upset and more things that she would do. So the ugliness grew and grew and grew. And, so I would spend more and more time on that porch, on that very front porch. That was kind of my safety zone where I would go. And this one particular evening, no one was home. My husband was at work at nighttime. My son was with his father. And my mother-in-law, I believe, had either gone to bed or was not there in the home. So it was very quiet, and the front porch is set up like an L-shaped with pillars and brick on the very front and brick stairs going down to my left. So there was like a half brick wall and two pillars in front of me where I would sit in this chair on the front porch. And you could have the porch light on and see just a little bit past where, you know, into the yard. And I had noticed something out of the corner of my eye, and I didn't really quite see it fully. I just thought it was like maybe, you know, a raccoon or something, scurrying across the yard or something like that. And a few minutes later, I would do a lot of, artwork, portrait drawing and stuff like that, sitting on that porch just in stillness and quiet. A few minutes later, after I had noticed that little movement out of the corner of my right eye towards the farthest pillar on the porch, I saw something else, and it was my form of pure evil manifesting into a solid entity. And I was in shock, completely in shock. And this was just like the crown top of a person, the crown top of their head, dark black hair. And then it pops down below the brick wall on the other side of where I was sitting. And I was trying to comprehend and process this in my brain. What was that? So after that, processing that in my head, like trying to come to terms with, okay, there's absolutely something on the other side of this brick wall. And it had ducked down, and I was too scared and still processing what was happening to the right of me. As I was doing that, there was no noise of foot movement, of feet walking in, you know, leaves and stuff right there beside the brick wall on the other side of the porch. So there was no foot sounds, steps being heard. So I'm still trying to understand that in itself. As I was processing that, this thing that I had only just seen the top of its head had popped back up with two very pale, bluish, white, long fingers, as well as a face. This was the epitome of evil that I believe my mother-in-law created from all of her jealousy and hatred towards me. This is what proved to me that true evil, true, horrible, ugly feelings like that do exist and can manifest into something so solid and scare me half to death. And when the face popped up over that brick and had her face, but it was white as a sheet, bluish even, with wet black hair, a gown on. She smiled in this horrible grin, all black eyes, and said that she was going to get me. And then she ducked back down again right after that. Took my breath away in fear and shock. I gripped the chair that I was sitting in and didn't quite know what to do. My heart was about to jump out of my chest. I was terrified. When she jumped down to duck again, I knew that it was coming closer to being right in front of me. And that's exactly what had happened. Again, no steps were heard. She just popped up closer to me and giggled in this horrible laugh. And I had never seen something so solid, so solid, evil. And I knew that this was a manifestation of all of the hatred she had towards me that had built up into this moment, this night. This was real fear that I could not put into real words to tell you how terrified I was. When she popped back up and was right in front of me, she said that she wanted to play with me and that she wanted to come and get me, with a laugh at the end. And when she said that, and the look on that face, even closer to mine, 3 feet away from me, in front of me, her next hop down would have been to hop over to the front stairs of this porch, which the front door was right in front of those stairs. I gained absolute superhuman speed and flew from that chair that I was sitting in to the front door in a blink of an eye and locked the door, ran into our room, which was right there, and absolutely locked every single lock. We had 3 locks on our bedroom door. That tells you how much I wanted to make sure we could stay away from her if we had to. So there I was, terrified, sitting there in that room alone until my husband came home. Needless to say, we moved within a week because before it was bad, but now I was fearful of my own life and being hurt physically or even worse, having my son hurt in some way. And I would live in a cardboard box before I would let anything like that happen. So within a week, we moved out of my mother-in-law's home into a townhouse. I met the most wonderful neighbor ever. She was so, so sweet. About a week after we had moved in, my mother-in-law had come by our townhouse, and my husband wasn't home, my son wasn't home. So I stepped out on our front little sidewalk area, and my neighbor lady had stepped out of her home and glanced over at me, and I waved at her and spoke with my mother-in-law for a few minutes. And you could just obviously tell I was just uncomfortable for a long time in front of her. So anyway, she went on about her business and left. And my neighbor came up to me and said, "Oh, that was your husband's mom, huh?" And I said, "Yeah, that's her. She goes, well, you didn't let her in. And I said, no, no, I didn't. And I have one of those faces. I can't lie. I'm not a good liar. My face doesn't lie anyway. So, and she looked at me and she said, well, I know why you didn't leave her, let her in is because she wasn't standing there alone, was she? And I just looked at her and she looked at me and every question in my head that I was questioning myself, like, did that really happen? Was I crazy? You know, and she just says that to me and I said, oh gosh, you know, I just started crying and hugged her and said, thank you. I'm not crazy. That happened. And that evil entity was still attached to her. I could see it standing behind her, right behind her neck. So she confirmed it, that I wasn't crazy. She had to let go of those feelings before she was going to be coming into my house. And so anyway, that's my story. Thank you guys so much. I love the show. Misty Jordan from South Carolina. Big fan. Keep up the good work. I thoroughly enjoy hearing everything you guys do. Thank you so much.
Excellent. See, that's how easy it is. Give us a call, 651-300-4977. That's 651-300-4977. Or you can email your stories to me, dave@darknessradio.com, and I will read them on an upcoming episode. How does that sound, Tim? I'll share their story right here on the air in an upcoming episode.
Well, I don't doubt that you will.
I will, just like, I'll tell you what. Email me your stories. If you think you've got a really good story you could tell in a narrative form, Tim, then we'll do it as an upcoming Theater of the Mind episode. But if you just have a short little story you want to share, I'll read it online like this one. Hi, Dave and Tim. I'm Glenn from sunny Glasgow in Scotland. Fair warning, this may run a bit long, Tim. He's giving us that warning up front.
Okay.
It's like a paragraph and a half. It's cute. Okay. Scout fella thinks that little thing is big. I've had a few experiences over the years, but the one I'm going to tell you about happened 25 years ago when I was around 14. Back then, I was best friends with a girl who lived up the hill from me. Most days, we'd hang out at her house. Now, her house wasn't like most other houses in the area. Most others were houses that were four houses in a close or apartment complex, as you might call it, over there in the Americas. And we're all on one level. Hers was two in a close and three levels, Tim.
Oh, all right.
Her room was in an attic, converted into a bedroom. A fair chunk of our time was spent playing the Ouija board. As we didn't have an actual one, we'd made it up by writing down the letters and symbols and using a glass as a planchette. Most of the time, it would move a little bit and then stop. But this one time, it was going mad, spelling out names, saying it was a demon, threatening us. Pretty freaky stuff, if you ask me, Tim. At that point, enough was enough, and we closed the session, and I went home. Not long after that, she came running to my house, and I said I had to come back up to hers. Walking up, I noticed everyone was standing outside. I asked what was wrong, and she just said, "Watch." Looking up at the windows, they started banging open and closed. The dogs inside were going barking mad and growling. And then the most horrible scream I've ever heard came from that room. I'll never forget that sound.
It was Prince? We all stood there,
freaked out, until she handed me the key and said to open the door. I wasn't slow in saying, fuck that. But a couple of minutes of arguing later, I was walking in, the closed keys in hand, and about to open the door. I'm not too manly to say I was terrified. I turn the lock. Please deposit $1.99 for the next 2 minutes of this story.
Aww.
Push the door open a bit, only to have it slammed in my face by whatever the hell was on the other side of that door. I backed away from the door and thought, no way am I going near that thing again. I didn't want to meet whoever that was. The house never felt right after that. A few minutes later, her mom and dad walked in the clothes, having been out shopping, asked why we were all outside, turned the key and walked right in the door without incident. We kind of creeped in behind him. As I said, the house never quite felt the same. And a couple of days later, a few of her dad's pigeons died. They weren't ill. They just died for no reason. We were sitting in the living room a few days later watching TV when there was a loud crash from the kitchen. We ran in to find three pots spinning on the floor. We absolutely bricked it and spent the rest of the day outside. Tim, they were outside.
Outside, you say?
They moved away, and not long after that, whether or not I had anything to do with the house, I never asked again. I contacted my friend before I sent this to make sure I had the details right, and it turns out she still has trouble with the paranormal, and I've usually got the feeling something's watching me. I do have more stories, but in true Beyond the Darkness fashion,
no,
I'll send them in another time.
No.
Thanks. And that comes from our friend Glenn.
Glenn.
See, because of that, that's why I did my Scottish accent through the whole thing.
I see.
Yeah. You like that one, Tim? I thought I brought it.
I thought so, too. I you know.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought I brought it. That's two. I think we had a Scottish story last week from Moira, didn't we? This week, new one?
Yeah.
Lots of good stories.
Yeah.
I don't know if Spooky Babe's good, but it's we got some good stories.
Well, you haven't brought your Stormy Daniels voice yet, but I'm waiting for that. Yeah.
I really don't know what it sounds like. And although I could go for the cheap, easy gag on this,
yeah,
I'm not going to this time, Tim. I'm just going to skip it because we might, I don't know, maybe I'll reach out to Stormy.
Yeah.
And ask her if she wants to do the show. She might. So let's be respectful. We never know.
Yeah. You never know.
There's a controversy brewing, Tim.
Oh.
A wee controversy brewing. We're here to report on it, Tim. The TV show Ghost Hunters not returning to A&E, according to series investigator Brandon Alvis.
What?
In what surprised fans and paranormal enthusiasts, Ghost Hunter star Brandon Alvis revealed in an interview with an internet radio talk show that A&E has no plans to bring the rebooted reality series appearing on Midnight Society. Alvis dropped the bombshell on October 12th, according to Ultimate Unexplained, and broke the news Saturday via his social networks. In the interview, the paranormal technician admitted he believes the network has no plans for the show to return for another season. I don't think so. No, I really don't, he said. I don't think it's going to happen. I think it's over at this point. Breaking news. Ghost Hunters is not coming back. There you go. Alvis goes on to praise the show and its crew, saying it was a great run with his fellow investigators. We did very well in the ratings. We beat everyone on Travel Channel and A&E, and Travel Channel and A&E, totally different networks and different structures and whatnot. First of all, that is incorrect information. I know that for a fact. They did not beat anybody on the Travel Channel.
Well, yeah.
Just putting that out there. A&E had problems within itself with the live PD stuff. That's a whole different story that I don't want to get into, he said. While he says fans can email A&E and ask them about the reason for the show not returning to the network, he speaks highly of his team and everyone he had the opportunity to work with. Grant Wilson was amazing. Everyone I worked with was fantastic, Alvis said, but more projects are coming soon. Mustafa Gadalari and I are very ready to go. You'll see more of us from pretty soon, him and I. Ghost Hunters originally premiered, of course, in 2004 on the Sci-Fi Network, ran for 11 seasons. Starring Wilson and Jason Hawes, the series served as a pioneer in the era of early paranormal reality TV. Producing more than 200 episodes and 10 specials, the series ended in 2016. Hard to believe 4 years ago already, but found new life with A&E last summer. The revival, featuring a new cast, ran for 2 seasons on the network, totaling 20 episodes, between August 21st, 2019 and May 27th, 2020. The show was produced by Lionsgate Pilgrim Media Group with Craig Pilligan and Mike Nichols serving as executive producers, along with original Ghost Hunters team leader Grant Wilson. Alongside Wilson and Alvis, the two were joined by fellow investigators Daryl Marston, Kristen Lumen, Gadalari, Brian Murray, and Rachel Stratton. In an interview with PopCulture.com last year, alongside their complete seasonal coverage, Wilson revealed the show was different from its first incarnation, primarily because of its fans. We recognize the fact that our audience has gotten smarter, Wilson said. They're kind of ready to move on from is it there or not. They're ready to take the next step. And so this rendition is much more of a personal nature and has much more humanity towards it. That's what he reported last year. Now you say, well, what's so controversial about that? Well, following news over the weekend from Ghost Hunters investigators Brandon Alvis and Mustafa Gadalari about the paranormal series not returning to A&E, The team leader, Grant Wilson, is now speaking out and clarifying talks surrounding the popular reality show's future. He shared a video on his Twitter and Instagram Monday afternoon, and Wilson got right into it, sharing that he had to clarify the question on everybody's mind. Is Ghost Hunters coming back? Let's go ahead and listen to what Grant had to say.
Hey guys, it's Grant from Ghost Hunters. I'm going to get right into it. The big question on everybody's mind is Ghost Hunters coming back? Now, I get hundreds of requests about this every day, and I haven't answered them, not because I'm trying to be rude, but as the executive producer of the show, I'm trying to get a real answer. And I've spent all this time trying to get a real answer from the network, and I don't have one. So I wasn't trying to be rude. I simply didn't have the answer you guys deserve. So as you know, like the show, we finished the show and wrapped it before the pandemic and it aired. But then that pandemic came and it turned everybody's life upside down and put things on pause. And it really, really shook up things at the network. And we were patient waiting for an answer because everybody's life was chaos. But it never came, and it still hasn't come. So to be perfectly honest, is this show canceled? Is it not? We simply don't know. Now, if A&E doesn't want the show, let's say they're moving in a new direction or whatever, I don't know. Remember, it can find another home. Originally, the show was on Sci-Fi, and it came back on A&E. So if A&E doesn't want it, someone else might. And so we'll wait and see there. Now, Even if another network wanted the show, I think it would be absolutely irresponsible to film this type of show right now. To go into someone's home, masked or not, and risk the safety of them, the crew, the team, would just be irresponsible. So I'm happy to wait until all this blows over to see what's going on. Now, again, I wouldn't normally even be answering this now, but recent events have brought this to light. And despite what you've heard, as executive producer of the show, I don't have an official answer. I'm not trying to be a wishful thinker here. I'm not trying to be a fatalist and say the show is not coming back. I'm trying to be as honest as I can with you guys. And I don't want to assume it's going away or that it's continuing. I just don't know. I'm still trying to get the answer. And when I have it, you'll have it. Trust me on that. So hopefully that clears things up. Not the answer I was hoping for. But as soon as I know, you'll know. So guys, I hope that answers some questions. Be safe out there. Be smart. And we'll see you around.
So you got it from the horse's mouth, Grant Wilson answering this. Now, again, as we said over the weekend, news broke that Elvis's social networks, Brandon Elvis from Ghost Hunters, that he has shared with an online radio show that he would not be returning to A&E. Paranormal historian and site analyst Gattolari followed up that news Sunday morning, admitting much of it had to do with the impact of COVID-19. From my understanding, one of the biggest reasons why the show wasn't getting renewed was that there was a lot of confusion in the beginning once COVID happened as to whether or not we would be able to produce the show in the manner in which we were doing. Gattolari said, there's a lot of traveling that's involved, and we didn't even know if we'd be able to get into places and film. So that's what's going on. Strange stuff. I've got to say this. You know, I mean, we've been friends with Brandon Elvis for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But he has been very controversial this past year.
Yeah.
He has taken to social media to kind of derail every other paranormal program, which, listen, there's enough room for everybody. By trying to belittle everybody else's work and claim yours is really the only legitimate work, I think makes you look kind of laughable. And I don't mean that disrespectfully or rude to Brandon, but, you know, in this world, there's already enough problems. And I think in our field, because of the nature of it and the speculative and skeptical nature of it, by going out and deriding other people, I don't think it does anybody any good. And it doesn't shine a better light on you and your program. I could easily rip apart every paranormal show if I wanted to and throw out allegations and claims and so on and so forth, but they're unfounded in most cases. And I don't know what goes on behind the scenes of making these shows work. So I'm not going to be one to throw people under the bridge. I may not agree with the techniques or styles or the investigations, but you know, it resonates with different people. And you kind of limit yourself by shooting down other shows, because you may have fans that like your show and Ghost Adventures and Ghost Nation and Holzer Files. But by tearing apart those other shows, it starts to, I think, cause some credibility on your own program. That's my take on it.
I get, in a sense, where Brandon's coming from. I get his sense of frustration. Where he's taking it, I disagree with. I get that he's trying to start discussion, but he's going about it the wrong way. His frustration is getting in the way of what he's trying to do, and that is he's trying to start a discussion amongst the paranormal community about how to go about change and getting people focused on getting, what's a good way of putting this? He wants to get people fired up about the right things in the paranormal community, about, you know, get it. But here's the thing. And this is where, you know, he's seen now both sides of the spectrum. You know, he's now been on a paranormal TV show, and he sees that there's an entertainment aspect to paranormal TV. Okay. And he very much is for lack of a better term, he wants to be a paranormal scientist. Okay. And I think there's a bit of frustration on his part that, you know, he wanted to bring paranormal science to television. And in that, I think his frustration was he couldn't just pop onto Ghost Hunters and be Bill Nye the Science Guy. Do you see what I'm saying?
Right. I agree.
I
could see frustration in that as well.
Yeah. And I, you know, as much as there is a section of the paranormal community that would love to see that, I think there's a huge swath of producers in the paranormal community that go, you know, some section of the program, that's fascinating, but not the entire program. You have to build a story. There has to be a story to the program in order to bring in the general audience. And I think there's frustration on Brandon's part that, you know what, but I've got all these gadgets here, and I can create a story with what I have here. And I think that's where he's butting heads with producers. And I think that he's brought that out into the open, where maybe he should be keeping that behind the scenes.
You know, and there's always the evolution. I mean, there are things on Holzer Files I'd like to see done differently. And, you know, they said as the show evolves, more and more different aspects of what we all want to see come to the show will most likely make its way there. It just takes a while, because you're setting a tone. You're setting the table for people to see the show and get into what we're doing, and then slowly evolve it. So I get what's going on with that as well.
And that's something that he can talk out with producers too. I mean, you know, like you said, it's an ongoing negotiation. And if this were something where, and again, we don't know if this is something where Brandon's getting frustrated and he's announcing the death of Ghost Hunters prematurely, or if this is something where, you know, he's announcing he's stepping aside and the show is continuing, or whatever is going on. We don't know for sure. Right. You know, if it's something where, you know, if the show is continuing, he can continue that negotiation behind the scenes. He doesn't need to bring it out in the open. To bring it out in the open is not going to further your cause any. You know, it never helps to bring a hostage negotiation out in the open, because all it does is make you look a little foolish. You know?
Agreed. All right. We've got just a couple stories left, and then I want to get into, Tim, a piece of audio that we've got and discuss a little bit about that. But let's jump in here as we step away from the controversy. Pukekeho poltergeist has terrified residents, and they're calling in a witch after some ghostly encounters. Ghostbusters are brought in to rid a Pukekeho home of evil spirits after terrified Filipino workers complained it's haunted by ghouls. The scared men report that troubling presences of three female spirits at the old Picchio Villa have engaged the services of a good witch now to cast them out. Skeptics, of course, say there are more scientific explanations for the men's experiences. Glenn Poole told the Herald the five-bedroom villa had been occupied by workers from the Philippines for 3 weeks. Poole, a manager with the scaffolding company employing the men, said the encounters began not long after they moved in. The first few days they were there, they came back to us and said, boss, the place is haunted. There's ladies in there, three ladies, lady ghosts. And we're like, yeah, okay. But after that, the things started happening. And they've been nonstop, he told the Herald. One man reported feeling a slap on the face in the middle of the night, waking to find out he was completely alone. The men also reported lights getting turned on and off, footsteps and running in the room. Poole said the men also claimed to have heard constant crying, the sound of women crying, and one of the men reported experiencing a form of sleep paralysis. He couldn't move. It was like something had a hold of his legs and was pinning him down. Poole also described the uncanny encounter one of the workers had on a video call to his wife in the Philippines. His wife got real snippy with him because she saw another woman behind him and swore, he swore black and blue that there was no one else there. The wife initially refused to believe the man's denials and insisted he was lying. Poole said the workers had leaned on their strong Catholic faith to deal with this issue, relating a conversation with one of the terrified men. Poole said that while the men said he wasn't fearful, he said, "The spirit, in the name of Jesus, please leave us alone." But that didn't work. Darwin Rivera, one of the Filipino workers living at the home, described feeling his legs being pulled up and down by an invisible force while he was laying in bed and experienced strange smells and sudden drops in temperature. Rivera said he heard women's voices crying, but had only heard them say one word, his name. He was now praying every night to keep himself safe and keeping his Bible close, but he admitted he was too scared to address the spirits directly and tell them to leave. The previous owners weren't surprised to learn of the spooky goings-on. "Been haunted, have they?" asked former owner Kim Tilliard before relaying some of his family experiences on the property, telling the Herald that the visitors said the house was not right. His wife, Christine, said the family lived there for about 24 years and initially had frequent run-ins with spirits. They had the house blessed several times, which would quell the disturbances for a while, and she had directly spoken with the spirits to tell them, "Go away and leave us alone." And they did. The family also placed protective angels on the four corners of the section. The spirits stopped returning, she said. The family hasn't encountered any paranormal activity for 2 decades before they sold the house in February. Christine said her young son woke up to find a figure standing over his bed and telling him to leave. She also recounted a chilling experience when one of their children was a baby. "She was grizzling, so I put her in between us, and when I woke up, there was somebody standing over me. It was something in a really long, dark cloak leaning over us. She was petrified and screamed out." Despite their experiences, Christine said the family learned to live with their spectral housemates, but they put safeguards in place. "We just kept the wardrobe door closed. There was a wardrobe in there that we just never opened. So I'd say they've opened the wardrobe door and whatever is in there has come back out." She also queried whether one of the spirits might be that of the mother of her mother, who died earlier this year and lay in the house for a time after her death. "That sort of thing my mom would do." Christine said she was a skeptic before her experiences at the house and had one piece of advice for the new occupants: get it blessed. The nuclear option. After some of the men's stories were shared on Facebook, Poole spoke with Karen Williams from Paranormal Investigators Haunted New Zealand, which has agreed to look into the case. Williams told the Herald that the Haunted New Zealand's work was not for profit and the investigators' results would be shared publicly online. The group planned to visit the property soon and was treating it as an urgent case. She said most members of the team had a scientific background and used photo and video to try and capture the evidence of what she admitted was a theoretical area. They will also use devices like spirit boxes and geoports to try to make communication. Williams, a practitioner of Wicca and a British traditional witch, said spirits often don't want to move on. "A ghost is a person who is no longer corporeal and they don't have a body anymore, but they're still the same person they were before. They have free will. If they are in a place, they may not want to move. You have to be persuasive." Williams said she will be using the nuclear option to remove the spirits. "This is where my Wiccan training comes in. There's a ritual I like to use, which is called the lesser banishing ritual of the pentagram, and it's a very powerful banishing ritual." Williams shared some details on the ritual with the Herald. The ceremony would be conducted using the Hebrew language and would call on the divine light to help cleanse the house. She never tried to convert skeptics, preferring to the late to let fate intervene instead. I think that skeptics fall into two camps. There's a camp of skeptics that genuinely doesn't believe that they've who doesn't believe it because they've never had an experience. Then there's another version of the skeptic, which is, I actually don't want to believe this. I'm really uncomfortable with it. I find it quite scary, and I will not think about it. Maybe one day they will have an experience that changes their mind, and they'll be calling on me. So it sounds like an interesting case. We're going to try to reach out to the New Zealand Haunted Paranormal Society, see if they can give us some updates on this case. And in our final regular story, Tim, we have another really weird one. And I've actually reached out to the author of a book to discuss this case. Unsolved Mysteries is back, of course, with their season two, or the second part of their batch of episodes for Netflix. And in the fourth episode of Netflix's newest season of Unsolved Mysteries, Kiyoshi Kanabishi, a Japanese sociologist specializing in disaster, tells us, I don't really believe in ghosts. I'm not the type of person who would see them. And honestly, same. Many so-called paranormal sightings are so obviously manufactured, it's a tough act to not be a bit cynical over the whole idea. But then you see something like Unsolved Mysteries, and it starts to make you question yourself repeatedly. As Unsolved Mysteries depicts, on March 11th, 2011, an earthquake caused a massive tsunami that hit the Tohoku region of northeastern Japan, and in its wake, it stole nearly 20,000 lives. In Ishinomaki, a town within the region, the trauma was intense and immediate. No one had prepared for this scale of disaster. The tsunami reached 131 feet at its peak, Tim.
Mm.
Good God, what is that, over 13 stories?
Yeah.
It swept away not only thousands of people, but their homes and memories, photographs, books, and altars. And although the episode doesn't mention it, the fallout only got worse from there. The earthquake triggered a nuclear meltdown at the nearby Fukushima Daiichi reactors, and the most severe such meltdown since Chernobyl. All of this together created a dramatic vacuum of grief to settle in, which Unsolved Mysteries explores in detail. What the show doesn't delve into is some of the strange happenings that took place after the disaster. Yes, there were many reported ghostly sightings, far more than other disasters, natural or otherwise, in Japan, such as the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But many of the ghosts described on the show were simply adrift, not angry. That wasn't always the case in reality. In his books, Ghosts of the Tsunami, Richard Lloyd Perry, a Tokyo-based journalist for the Times of London, reported on the phenomena. His series of stories are wide and far-reaching, many of them more unsettling than the fairly commonplace ghost stories depicted in Unsolved Mysteries. Sure, there was a sighting of a lone woman standing in the middle of nowhere wearing a scarlet dress. There was an old neighbor who allegedly appeared in her friends' homes and leave a saltwater stain on the cushion where she sat. But perhaps most shockingly, there was a builder. Perry gives him the name Takeshi Ono, who says he was possessed. He'd growl like a beast, roll in the mud outside his house, stare at figures walking past his home. He'd turn repeatedly on the family, snarling, "Drop dead! Everyone else is dead, so die!" For answers, he went to Reverend Kanita, the lovely, friendly-looking monk who appears in the Unsolved Mysteries episode. According to Perry, the reverend splashed Ono with holy water until his head went clear. Then he revealed to Ono that the possession was possibly a punishment. Ono traveled into the devastated area, flippantly eating an ice cream. "Something got a hold of you, perhaps the dead who cannot accept yet that they are dead," the reverend told Ono. "They have been trying to express their regret and their resentment through you." Perry writes in his book that priests from multiple belief systems, including Christian, Shinto, and Buddhist, were called upon in those months after the tsunami to quell the many unhappy spirits. It didn't necessarily matter whether these religious leaders believed in exorcisms or not. They were needed. In an interview with NPR, Perry explained, "I asked Reverend Kanita about it once, and he said it doesn't matter whether the ghosts really exist or not. He said what matters is that people believe in them. These experiences are real." So he never said to people, "Pull yourself together. You're not really possessed. You just think you are." That's the point of view I take. It doesn't really matter whether you believe in ghosts. What's real is the suffering and the pain that has been left behind from this trauma. Unsolved Mysteries also takes a look at the Okawa Elementary School of the 75 students who died there at school during the tsunami, 74 were from Okawa, an unsettling truth that led parents to rail against larger bureaucratic failures. One Japanese magazine reported that the disaster, kids would dare one another to travel to the elementary school grounds in search of student ghosts. One mother of an Okawa student consulted with a psychic, Perry reported. They traveled together to the school grounds, and after the mother tried decorations into the surrounding bamboo trees, the psychic told her the deceased children were delighted with them. But he also described horrifying scenes of the veneer beneath or between life and death, describing that the dead were crawling on the ground near the school, some of them stuck in the water, covered in mud, swallowing the dirty water in terrible suffering. Some of them were trapped and trying to get out, the mother described to Perry. Terrifying story. We're going to try to work and hopefully get Mr. Perry on the show in the future here to discuss this case with us. Now, the final story, Tim, that we have is not so much a story, but I just want to say this. Somebody that I really like and respect that is not necessarily part of the paranormal field, but is a historian and researcher and is one that is firmly grounded and rooted in reality of history, asked me to listen to something. And he was turned on to this by some forces, and that makes it sound paranormal, by some people that he felt compelled that I should hear this audio and perhaps we should share it with our audience. Now, this audio I'm going to tell you about, Tim, is a little unique, and it's got this mechanical voice, as we mentioned in the beginning. It's very human AI sounding, and it's about a 10-minute audio. I want to play that audio, and I would like to hear from our listeners. And the reason we're playing this is because nobody wants to be discussing it after the fact and oh, well, sure, how do we know they didn't put this video up after and claim that it was up before? So we're going to play this video. It's interesting. And here's why it's interesting to me, Tim. Three stories in today's news, all released this week. Demi Lovato, Miley Cyrus, Khloe Kardashian talking about UFOs.
Mm-hmm.
There's been so much disclosure leaking out this year. I have it on good authority from another reputable source that they were contacted and told that the government in 2017 had finally decided we need to start to let this information out. We have to prepare people for something that's coming. And they claim they've seen the documents. Somebody I trust.
Okay.
Somebody I believe. Somebody who I don't and is not trying to gain notoriety or publicity for this, but is telling me something big is coming. And it ties in with many different things that are taking place, which is covered in this audio. So I wanted to ask you before we play the audio, with all we're seeing and the videos, the Pentagon admitting that they still have an active investigation going on, you've got ATIP, you've got the Academy to the Stars, you've got all of these things happening. You've got, we've talked on the show and we've got some more shows on UFOs and really, really interesting aspects. As a matter of fact, they just keep getting more intriguing to me about UFOs and disclosure. Do you think that, we are being readied for something, or do you think we're just grasping out of hope because 2020 is so weird? If it's going to happen, this would be the year.
I always question why, and we're being prepped for something, but why? And it's kind of the, you know, they show you one thing, but they're preparing you for a left hook. You know, it's kind of like watch the birdie, why something else is hitting you from the other side.
Sleight of hand, right?
Yeah, sleight of hand. So I question why, you know. A lot of times when you see these different things that are coming out, it's sleight of hand for something else that's hitting you from the other side. Whether it be, you know, there's an uptick in coronavirus numbers. Oh, by the way, here's a UFO tape. Here's a revelation about UFOs. Here's a political scandal. Oh, here, by the way, here's another UFO tape. You know, so it seems to me that there's, you know, there's corresponding reasons why we get, you know, other things. And I know we don't typically talk about political stuff on the show, but it seems like the worse things get in the world, the more we get fed some entertaining alien stuff. So I question why it is we're getting more and more of this stuff.
I agree. And I see your points on a lot of this. And I'm starting to look at, like I said, you know, could you know, there's so many weird elements coming out. If there is disclosure, if there is something coming that is going to change things, could 5G be more of a net that's being placed over our planet to detect things? And they're providing it as cell phone stuff. Could COVID be something that was released on purpose because it's possibly something that invaders could not tolerate and humanity will take a loss, but the devastation will be less by the disease than what could be coming? Or is it more of a time of enlightenment? I don't know. There's a lot of weird things, a lot of strange conspiracies that are intriguing to me. But let's go ahead. We're going to play that audio. I want you, the listeners, to listen to this. Seriously, listen. Just give 10 minutes of your time to this. Listen to it. Email us your thoughts on this, and we'll continue having this discussion on future episodes. But here you go. Enjoy.
The event 2020, major victory for the light. Pleiadian Light Forces Transmissions, October 8, 2020. Channeled by Michael Love. A special message to the star seeds of New Earth, for immediate planetary broadcast. Prelude. The following information is derived from direct, decoded etheric transmissions from benevolent light forces docked in Earth's solar system, and some of the data comes directly from certain inside Earth Alliance members known as the White Hats, and the Great White Brotherhood, strategically placed in key positions of power by the galactics on the surface of planet Earth. Great Ones. Recent Earth Alliance intel indicates that light forces have now achieved a major victory in Operation Pandora over remaining Draco forces in sublunar space, for the liberation of planet Earth. Only light beings who are tuned into the higher realms are aware this battle is even occurring, let alone how important it is. This energetic clearing operation has been occurring behind the scenes on behalf of humanity for some time now to pave the way for humanity's imminent grand evolutionary event. Many do not know that over the last 3 Earth weeks, there were some very close calls that occurred as light forces were finalizing the programming of Earth's new 5DVTXC energy grid. A strong Pandora security breach was initiated by nefarious forces last week, but it was quickly deflected and neutralized by Delta light forces. Due to the critical nature of humanity's coming ascension event, 72 Earth hours ago, planetary light forces deployed a major offensive in sublunar space against these remaining nefarious beings who have still been holding the Earth hostage. The Earth Alliance now reports that light forces have emerged 100% victorious from this final hellacious battle above the Earth. The great battle for planet Earth is finally coming to its end, and for the first time in modern history, sublunar space has been completely cleared of these dark Draco entities. You are going to witness all remaining Earth Cabal entities being removed and brought to justice over the coming weeks as Operation Pandora sweeps across the planet. The Earth Alliance says, the energetic clearing that is underway will now quickly filter itself down onto the surface, and the citizens of planet Earth will begin to experience magnificent new energies of freedom and lightness as Earth's gamma timeline moves forward toward the event culmination 2020. You will hear about all of it in the coming days, Great One. And it will indeed be an incredible October surprise. Light forces also say this recent energetic clearing will reach a major positive turning point on Earth's timeline during the first week of November 2020. The grand ascension of humanity is now imminent as light beings clear the way. Past direct Earth Alliance intel indicates in every way that a spectacular event is about to occur on Earth, where consciousness levels will be increased to the fifth dimensional level. This is the time spoken of old by many prophets and visionaries, when humanity would begin moving from the long period of cosmic darkness, back into the blinding new light of the Golden Age. We can tell you that December 21, 2020 is a very special moment on the galactic wheel of time and in human history. At that grand marker in time at 11:11 a.m. UTC, the new Golden Age of Aquarius will finally dawn for humanity, and the new 5D Earth will be born on Earth. Not since the grand days of Lemuria and Atlantis in Earth's prehistory have we experienced glorious fifth dimensional energies on the surface of the planet. A major energetic ascension portal will open in the heavens on December 21, 2020, as celestial alignments mark the great time of humanity. Due to the cosmic alignments near the end of December, the central sunlight of the glorious Satyuga Golden Age, which began in 2012, will shine again on planet Earth. This point on Earth's gamma timeline and marked in the heavens signifies the beginning of humanity's long-awaited evolutionary ascension event. The cosmic gates will be fully opened on that day, and the most powerful, unstoppable, and blinding stream of 40 Hz gamma light in history will blast through the heavens and flow into the planet. Here are the major celestial events of Earth year 2020, some of which that have already occurred, that are leading up to the December 21, 2020 Grand Alignment. A rare 3,000-year triple conjunction, in a 33-year Saturn-Pluto conjunction. A 13-year Jupiter-Pluto conjunction. The annular solar eclipse, that also happened to fall on the exact same day as the 2020 summer solstice. A 20-year Jupiter-Saturn great conjunction that falls on the most significant solar day of the year, the December solstice. The powerful upcoming alignment of December 21, 2020, known as the Great Conjunction, coincides with the ending and beginning of major celestial cycles, has powerful synchronistic meaning, to say the least. The Pleiadians know very well what is in store for humankind, and they are here in mass numbers assisting in this great dimensional transition. The series of magnificent heavenly events of Earth year 2020 will herald the beginning of a new era of light on planet Earth. The Great Solar Flash. Coinciding with major cosmic cycles ending and beginning right now, plus the celestial alignments and stargates that are opening, is the fact that our Sun is due any moment to have its Great Flash, which happens every 25,920 years in what is known as the Great Cycle. This galactic flash of white magnetic light from the galactic core has been known by almost every ancient civilization in recorded history. It has been written with names as Sambarteka Fire, Frashokereti, Ekpyrosis, and Yuga Fire. The data in all recent Earth Alliance transmissions shows this grand solar flash is also imminent, and all signs and data point to the fact that this event may also occur before the end of Earth year 2020. Certain members of the Earth Alliance know about the certainty of this solar event and confirm that our solar system is passing through an extremely energetically dense area of the galaxy at this very hour, and the exotic particles contained in this cosmic plasma field are charging the galactic core up like a giant supercapacitor, which will soon discharge as an epic and cosmic light event that will be seen by all beings on the surface of the Earth. The grand solar flash will be viewed from the surface of the Earth and witnessed as a second sun in the sky. The energy released from this central sun emission is known as the compression breakthrough and will trigger the full mass ascension event of planetary consciousness. Ancient sages say the light from this cosmic blast will be so powerful, it will light up the skies of Earth for a period of 1,000 years. This golden light of the New Age is the divine light that will illuminate planet Earth during the next millennium. On December 21, 2020, our entire galaxy will move into the fifth dimension, also known as the New Age of Aquarius and the Sixth Golden Age. On this evolutionary day, planet Earth will enter the celestial age of spiritual awakening. The spiritual forces of the central sun will change everything in this realm in profound and positive ways. Those who wish to live in harmony, sharing, caring, cooperating and working with nature, creativity, and love will form spiritual communities and an entirely new and different civilization. The new Aquarian age brings in the realization of our true divine selves, and in this, all things become possible and a state of perfection is reached. We have waited for this grand moment for eons and have endured many things on planet Earth, incarnating over and over, countless times, just to behold the glorious appearance of the new golden age. We have maintained hope through it all, and we have overcome the whole world just to be able to stand on the Earth and witness the magnificence of what is coming. It is our ticket home, Great One. The great time has finally arrived. What is coming is big, it's coming fast, and it's headed straight for planet Earth, in 2 Earth months. Stand by as we move towards the final phase of the event 2020. Planetary Energy Update, October 8, 2020. Energies around the planet are expected to rise again this weekend, so take the best care of your layered body system right now. You are taking more and more light into your cells, and your DNA is activating more and more each day. We suggest that you only ingest natural energy foods, stay grounded in nature, get plenty of rest, meditate at least 1 hour per day and use crystals to help channel these high vibrational energies through the body. Thank you for coming to Earth at this time and for your great service to all of humanity. Godspeed. Michael and the Pleiadians. 5DEarthProject.com. Special credit and acknowledgement to the Earth Alliance, the Great White Brotherhood, the White Dragon Society, Pleiadian codename, Cobra, the Guardians of Earth and the Sphere Being Alliance.
A lot of that audio is very weird, very metaphysical, esoteric in nature, but there's aspects of that, like I said, that can be followed up on, that we can actually see these alignments are coming, that things are taking place. In this message, again, I would normally kind of roll my eyes at these channeled messages, but the fact that I'm getting this from a few different sources and people I like and respect who are concerned and believe that there is something to this, mm-hmm, is what really wanted me to share this on the episode. So it's intriguing. Send us your thoughts, dave@darknessradio.com. We'll continue this discussion on future episodes. And I want to give you a chance, Tim. I know you're just hearing this. I want to give you a chance to absorb it, and we can discuss this maybe a little bit further next week on the show.
Okay.
And after you've had a little bit of time to absorb it, and I'm going to re-listen to it a few more times as well and see what we take away from this. But I wanted it now so that if and when these things happen, we talked about it on the show beforehand. And more importantly, if it comes and goes and these dates pass with nothing changing, we can discuss that as well. It's just, again, go into it with an open dynamic. I think there's something at play here, folks, that could be explaining a lot what's going on through the veil and changes that are taking place. Why hauntings, strange creature sightings, UFOs are being witnessed more and more. Is it out of boredom and people just looking for their 15 minutes of stardom? Or is there something bigger at play? So check it out. Write to me and let me know your thoughts. That's it for this week. I hope you enjoyed the show as much as we enjoyed bringing it to you. You can find links for a majority of the stories that have clips, video, audio, things like that on our news page, darknessradio.com. Click on the news tab. You'll find that there. And listen, if you want some great gift items and some cool new board games and fun paranormal themed items, go to darknessradio.com. Click on the store tab. Go in there. You'll have a link to our Amazon store. Please, bookmark that link, because anytime you go in through our link and make any purchase, a very small portion of those proceeds go to the radio show. So it doesn't affect the seller, doesn't affect the buyer in any way. Nothing is jacked up. It's just a little bit that they put in there for this program that we've got. But we put together great books from all of the different shows that we've done for paranormal, true crime, and things to watch, and great swag from gift items to clothing and so much more. So go check that out at darknessradio.com. Click on that store tab. For Tim Dennis, I'm Dave Schrader. Thank you for tuning in to the best in paranormal talk radio. We'll be back tomorrow with more Darkness Radio.